That's what the people in those parts have. Great. The five of us are ready. Thank you for the.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Sister Denise. Oh, what a powerful study lesson. Standing for the truth. Amen. 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 Thank you, my sister. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I want to thank all of you for joining in on this powerful discussion. Thank you for that as well. So, now it's time for us to prepare ourselves for worship. It's time for you to get your heart and your mind in tune with God.
Amen.
Everything that's outside that door must stay outside that door. Once you come into the house of God, you to give it all to Him. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. So, let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, thank you for blessing us with a beautiful study today. Thank you for blessing us with your woman servant that she was able to come and lead out and study today. And thank you for all those who participated. Father, we pray right now that the Holy Spirit will be in our hearts and minds as we prepare ourselves to worship you and give you all the praise and glory. And we pray for traveling mercy for all those who are still making their way here to the house of God to worship. So thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Oh.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean, so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now.
Let's sing along, y'all.
You are Jireh. You are enough.
I can see so clear what it's all about.
So stay by my side when the sun goes down. Don't wanna forget how I feel right now.
Jireh,
Jireh, you are enough.
I know that you are.
Jireh,
you are.
I'm already chosen. I know who I am.
Caught into his power, working it out. So today, I just want to just enjoy being in the presence of God and just allow the Holy Spirit to move through you so that whatever is going on in your life, you're just letting God have it. Amen? Don't let burdens be so hard on us that we're trying to take them on. No, we are instructed. This is what the Bible says, to give our burdens to Him. So let's just celebrate, be happy. Those of you that are joining us, enjoy the service as we continue along. Thank you and God bless.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. Our call to worship is going to be taken from Psalms chapter 50, verses 1 to 6, and I'm going to read it to you from the Clear Word version. This chapter is basically entitled, God, the Righteous Judge, Will Come. It says, the Lord, the mighty God, will summon the whole world from the east to the west when He comes. His presence will shine from Zion, from Jerusalem, a city perfect in beauty. Our God will come and will not be silent. He will come surrounded by fire, flashes of light, and manifestations of power. He will call on heaven and earth as witnesses to His judgment and vindication of His people. He will say, "Gather my faithful people. Gather them to me, everyone who has accepted the covenant of my sacrifice." And verse 6, then those in heaven will bring in the verdict that God is just and altogether righteous. He is judge of the earth. Amen. At this time, we are going to ask the Lord's blessing. Then we're going to invite Sister Sky to come up and do our call to worship and, I'm sorry, our affirmation of faith. Father, which art in heaven, we thank You for this beautiful Sabbath day. Thank You for Your people that have gathered together today. Bless them, keep them, and may we worship You like never before. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Sister Sky? I'm excited for her.
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before His presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It's He that made us and not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth enduring to all generations. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and the earth, the sea and the all them is, and rested the Sabbath day. Live for the Lord, bless the Sabbath day, and hallowed.
And great job, Sister Sky. She is in my youth class, or young adult class. She's brilliant. You got a smart young lady over there. And not only brilliant, yes, you may have a seat, not only brilliant as far as ABCs and 1-2-3s, but I'm talking about the Word. Today we were talking about miracles, and one of the things that they had to do was talk about how many miracles you can remember. She was just listing them off. I was like, man, she might know a little bit more than me. And so, Sky, it's wonderful to see young people in the church.
And one of the things that we also do in our youth class, and this is a shout out, anybody on YouTube and Zoom and Facebook that's watching, come on out. If you're 13 up to 20, we got something for you. One of the things is we talk about music and Christian music. And her insight into the song that we looked at today and the way that she explained it, because at the end of the day, we're going to be saved on our own cognizance. We're not going to heaven on somebody's coattails. Oh, because I go to New Life and Pastor Thorpe's my pastor, I'm going to make it to heaven? It don't work like that. You've got to study to show yourself approved. And she's on the right track. And so that was an inspiration to me to make sure I keep studying so I can teach the young people when they come the truth. And so I would just say to each and every one of you, making sure that you know the truth as well. So as we wrap up, we're going to have our mission statement, which says, our mission here at New Life is to introduce what? In the lives of people and within our community through what, church? That's it. We talk about it all the time. Basic instructions before leaving Earth, the Bible, and that's what we wholly stand on. And change means choosing to have a new growth experience with who? Jesus Christ, absolutely. Therefore, so our scripture is, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. Well, we're going to go through a few announcements. And so we're going to start off with our April birthdays. Wow, can you believe it? We are what, 2-3 weeks into April? January, February, March, April. We're almost halfway through 2024 already. We have Zoe Benz on the 1st. Sharika Johnson was on the 2nd. Shauna K. Jones was the 3rd. Cynthia Taylor, the 8th. Shonda Whitler, the 8th. Josiah Saunders, the 9th. Aaron H. the 2nd, the 11th. Tynara Jones, the 14th. I haven't seen her for a long time, but I saw her picture on Facebook. She is growing so beautiful and her children. We continue to pray for Tynara and her family. Symphony Steele, the 18th. That was yesterday. Wow. Israel Cousin. It was Thursday. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it. Israel Cousins, the 22nd. I don't know if you guys have seen Israel lately. That boy is what, like 6'4"? Almost like a grown man. I'm like, wow. You do. He's on the 22nd. And Sister Shana Ellis, mother of Tynara Jones, is the 26th. Again, we keep that family in prayer. We love them. Their children, amazing. And so happy birthday to everyone in the month of April. Because April showers bring, wait, what is it? May flowers. Absolutely. All right, Park Church, game night tonight at 8 p.m. till the fun is done. Now, judging on some of us, I don't know how late that's going to be. I have a friend in Bermuda, right? No joke. Big shout out to you, Warren, if you're watching. So we've got we call it Praying Dads Group. All of us are God-fearing men, fathers, husbands, and it never fails. 7:45, 8 o'clock, all right, you boys, I'm getting a little tired. I'm going to have to call it a night tonight. We're like, what? It's not even 8 o'clock. And so that's saying 8 p.m. until the fun is done. So obviously, we're going to try and have as much fun all the way through. Come on out, bring your games, whatever games you like. I know last time we had one here, they introduced me to a pretty cool game called Tenzi. What is it? Yeah, Tenzi, and I had so much fun. Brother Jay is trying to still get me to play this game called Dati Uno. I'm not falling for it. I'm not falling for it. But anyway, it is a fun time. It also gives us an opportunity to have fun amongst each other. We don't only have to know each other because we sit in the pews and praise. We can be social together. Because when I make it to heaven, I know I'm going to be praising God. But I may say, hey, Brother Hannah, let's go fly and check out this other world. You better come hang out with me, my brother. So let's try to get together tonight at Park Church. Next announcement. Oh, I love it. I'm going to have to look up here because my, well, New Life Cougars, along with Family Life Ministry, are going to have a bowling fundraiser. I know we have quite a few people that enjoy bowling right here in this church. It is one of those sports you don't even have to be good at it. You know, you could put the bumpers up. Can I get an amen? So you can just take that ball and toss it down. Even if it's going in the gutter, the bumper will push it back. The bumpers kind of remind me of the Holy Spirit. He gives you that extra boost, that chance to hit those pins. So it is going to be May 19th. What date?
May 19th.
At 1 p.m. Southbound Bowling Alley in Fruitland, Maryland. See the, well, we don't have bulletins, but we will continue to post it. We will talk about, oh, the bulletin board. Thank you. Thank you. That's why I need to put my, you know what? Let me put my glasses on. Stop embarrassing myself. It's okay. The bulletin board for more information. And so that sounds like a wonderful night as well. We're doing everything that we can to promote our Pathfinders, making sure that we get the funds that they need to make this amazing experience. I have personally had the opportunity to go to a camporee. Life-changing. I would never, ever forget it. To have over 30,000 Pathfinders in one location, camping and learning about God, it was so cool. I was part of, I don't know if you know, it was a competition called Bigfoot. And what they would do is they would take a 4x4 boards, two of them that were about 10 feet long, and they had ropes. And it was six people, and we each stood in a straight line holding the ropes on the board, and we had to work together. So it would be right, left, and all of the Pathfinder teams were lined up. And I was part of that team from the St. George's Cowhouse. This was way, way, way back. And we ended up coming third in that competition, and I was also part of the drill team. We'd be like, left turn. So I knew what it was about. It was a fun time. And so I'm so glad to see that Sister Gabby and Sister Deborah and Sister Tyann are doing everything that they can to get our young people to that place. If you have not donated, just dig deep. I mean, I'm giving. We're giving. Our department's giving. So if you haven't, please make sure. So let's make sure that we encourage those leaders and our Pathfinders on this amazing journey. Yeah, that's right. And so it says New Life Cougars Pathfinder Day. Oh, that's exciting. The theme, the promise of his coming. Saturday, June 15, 2024, right here at New Life Seventh-day Adventist Church. For more information, please contact our Pathfinder Director, Sister Gabby, and her information is there, 302-362-3459. And our guest speaker will be Pastor Patrick Graham. So I'm looking forward to that. He's got his stars and everything, so he's got quite a few badges. And so that should be a wonderful day as well. All right, May 4th, immediately following our service, we will have a potluck. Sign up on the sheet, on the table in the foyer. And so last time we had, and Aunt Helen said that she's not here today, one of the best potlucks that she's had here at this church. The food was amazing. I remember when my plate came, I was like, mercy, God is good. And so the food tasted good as well. And so if you are a cook or you're good at making whatever dish, please make sure that you sign up so that we can have an amazing potluck on May the 4th. That's about, 2 weeks from today? Yep, 2 weeks from today. All right, at this time, are there any other announcements before we move on to children's story that may not have gotten to Brother Dre, Brother Trey, and Brother Jay to be able to post on our announcements? If by any chance you do have an announcement, please reach out to them so that they can put it on our overhead and so that it can also be posted on our YouTube as well as our Facebook. Brother Dr. H? Congratulations. Oh, you want me to translate? So Dr. H's son, Dominic, will be graduating May 11th. Dr. H, did I say that correct? Dr. H, he's graduating RAND May 11th. And so from Oakwood University, so we want to recognize that. And so with that said, we do have a number of people that will be graduating this year. I know Sister Karen, and who's one of our new members, the daughter of Sister Rosa. She's graduating from Y High. Dominic's graduating from Oakwood. I think Sister Rosa is also graduating from college. So we'll be getting in touch with Sister Cherie Allen, who is our education leader, to have our program, our senior presentation right here. So I'm looking forward to that. We've had an amazing, amazing time when it comes to senior presentation. All right, well, thank you. If there are no more announcements at this time, we're going to call Brother Trey Ford for our children's ministry.
All right, let us have prayer over the offering. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for blessing us with another Sabbath that we can come together one more time. Thank you for allowing us to collect this funds to help further your work. Please bless it and stretch it to do what needs to be done and to bring those closer to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
All right. Good morning, boys and girls. Good morning, church. All right, we're going to go over our preliminaries first, and we are learning our 10 commandments. I believe we are on our third commandment. So, Sister Eva, take it away.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Good morning, boys and girls. Happy Sabbath. The 10th commandment for number 3 is, thou shalt not take his name of the Lord of God, their God, in vain. Exodus 20, verse 7. What do that mean to you?
Anybody? Anybody know what it means to take the name of God in vain. There you go. That's exactly
thank you,
it.
Stephanie.
She said saying it, not being earnest about it. You're not really talking about God or to God. You're just saying it to say it. That's exactly it. That is what we don't want to do. Now, today, our children's story will be about promises, all right? How many of you know what a promise is? Yes. What is a promise? Say it one more time.
You promise somebody that you promise.
Okay. All right. It is involving two people. Anybody else? Or it could be more than two people. Yes, go ahead, Max.
If you say that you'll do something, you have to do it.
Okay. I like that. So for those that don't know, a promise is a declaration or an assurance that one will do a particular thing or that a particular thing will happen. Promises are very important because if you promise something and you don't keep your word, you are deemed untrustworthy and a liar. What if I said, I promise, if you can tell me what 12 times 12 is, I will give you how much that is in dollars. Do you know what it is? 144. Is that correct? That is correct. Now, what if I told you, Max? Oh, man, I'm sorry. I can't do it. That's too much money to give you. I will not be able to keep my promise. How would that make you feel? Okay, that's a good answer. I like that. You would probably feel like Max said, mad. I know I would. I'd be angry. And you'd probably feel let down, all right? This is why we shouldn't make promises that we can't keep. Can anyone name some things that God has promised us? Yes, go ahead, Max. He promised that he will come back, correct? Anyone else? All right, let me tell you some of the promises that God has made, all right? God promises us that he will provide us peace that passes all understanding. Huh? He promises us that he will renew our strength when we are weak. He promises to hear us when we pray. He promises to forgive us of our sins if we ask earnestly. He promises to walk with us every step of the way. He promises to never fail you nor forsake you. He promises that he has a plan for you, and he promises to provide for you. I want to talk to you today in particular about a promise that he made way back when to some people called the Israelites. God promised them something called the Promised Land, all right? If Gabby could pull up our slide, I want to welcome you to the Promised Land. Let me fix it. All right, if you can bring that up. Welcome to Israel, the promised land, all right? Now, as you can see, the promised land is an area that God swore to give to his chosen people, the descendants of Abraham, and the territory was located on the eastern end of the Mediterranean Sea. Today, this is known as Israel. All right. Our Bible verse of the day is Genesis 13:15. All the land that you see, I will give you and your offspring forever. All right. God gave specific details of the boundaries and told Moses that the land may not be sold in perpetuity, which means forever, because the land is God's. Now, let me share some cool facts about Israel that you may or may not know, aka the Promised Land. All right, did you know that it is only 290 miles from north to south, which means it's actually smaller than the state of New Jersey? But don't let this size fool you. The landscape of Israel is actually very astonishing. What do I mean by that? I'll show you. Let me be your travel guide and take you on a ride through Israel. So let's go to the next slide. All right. Right here, I'll show you. Imagine skiing down the snowy slopes of Mount Hermon 1 minute, right? And you can go to the next one. Then driving a couple hours south so you can go snorkeling in the crystal clear waters of the Red Sea. If we go to the next slide, we'll be in the Galilee region with lush greenery and rolling hills. And there's also the stark beauty of the next slide, which is the Negev Desert, home to breathtaking waterfalls, which we will show on the next slide. All right. And if that isn't enough, on our next slide, you can actually float around in the Dead Sea, which is the lowest point on Earth. Now, wouldn't you say this is a pretty good land that God promised his people? All right. Also, let's not forget the rich history involving their culture and, of course, Jesus. Israel has the most computers, museums, and college degrees per capita than any other place in the world. It is the only place in the Middle East where the number of Christians is actually increasing. Also, their life expectancy in Israel is around 82 years old. These might be some of the reasons why you would say God called this land the land flowing with milk and honey. But you may be asking yourself, man, that sounds like a great place, and I would love to go there one day, right? And I'd be right there with you. I'd love to go too. But did you know that God has promised each and every one of us something even greater than that? Also, it's completely free. We don't even have to pay for a plane ticket. Yes, I am talking about salvation. God has promised salvation to those who choose to believe in him and to follow his commandments, the ones that we are learning each month. It is because of this promise that we have hope to not only be saved from condemnation, but to reach a place called heaven, where I can assure you things are way better than what even Israel has to offer. It is important to note, though, that you can't take a promise for granted either. What happens when you take a promise for granted, guys? Anybody know? Okay, I'll tell you. You will potentially miss out on a blessing. If you do, you could end up like some of the Israelites, actually, and miss out on the promised land. So let's remember to hold on to God's promises and have faith that he is one that keeps his promises. Now, I would like to make a promise with you guys that if you remember one of our stops that we made in Israel, if you can tell me next week, I have something special for you guys. is going to require you to remember for a whole week at least one of the places we stop to in Israel, okay? Yes, all of you. All right, now let's have prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for the many promises that you've blessed us with, and allow us to always remember them and keep them in our hearts so that if we follow you, that we will one day make it to the kingdom and be with you forever. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So have our theme, I will give God more in 2024. All right. So on three, one, two, three. And I will give God more in 2024. You guys may go back to your seats.
Yep, give God more. So fitting that we say we'll give more, and then next is tithe and offering. You know, we all have various means of income, and some of us have retired and still have pension that comes through. But one of the things that God has asked each and every one of us to do is to give one-tenth of our income and our earnings. You know, even way back when Cain and Abel were around, he gave them specific instructions. And it's important that as God's children, we comply and follow those instructions. He's a God of order. And so when you think about a tenth of everything that you bring in, you earn a dollar, you have to give how much? 10 cents. You earn $10, you give how much? You earn $100, you give how much? So when you think about that, I give 10, how much do I have left? 90 of the one, I'm sorry, of the 100. If I give my $10, I still have $90 that I can use. But then he says, you know what? You can give a free will offering. However you feel of that 90, you just give some more. And so it's not my place to tell you how much to give. That's between you and God. All I know is that he's asked us and commissioned us to give 10% and then give a free will offering. So as our ushers and deacons come today to get our tithes and offerings, are you giving as a cheerful giver, or are you giving begrudgingly? I don't know about you, but I love giving my gifts to my children with a smile. I actually love to give more than I receive. I tell the people at my job all the time, giving for me means nothing. I love it. I love it. I love it. And so I hope as Christians and God's children, we can get to that point that giving means nothing. It just comes to us naturally because God gave us the greatest gift of all time, his son, who came and died for us. So giving 10% in a free will offering should mean nothing. Now we have various ways to give. You can give your hard-earned cash where it's physical and tangible. You can give it online. Even if you want to stop by and have out of the meal, pick it up in front of you at your house, we will do that as long as you'll give your free will. At this time, our ushers and our deacons, they can come.
opportunity this weekend to help secure salvation by giving our time. Also ask that you bless us just like you did the 5,000, multiply it, expand it so that it can play its part in spreading the gospel through the entire world. And then we know that you will come back to save your children. Bless it again, we ask. Bless those that were able to give, and even bless those that were unable to give their heart.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Sister Helen asked me to go ahead and lead off today, so I pray that you guys are blessed and we are all able to sing together on these hymns. The first one was going to be "My Hope is Built on Nothing." Sing when we all get to heaven. So once we find out that God is our solid ground, our hope is that we will all get to heaven, right? So let's go ahead and sing when we all get to heaven. Sing. Sorry, guys. I'll just, I'm not used to being up here by myself, so. That's fine. That's fine. I'll be fine. All right, let's go. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy. Blessed assurance that Jesus is mine or ours. Which one? Mine personally and ours all together. So we have that blessed assurance that he's ours.
Thank you. my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Christmas, my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising
been blessed to sing. I can't wait to make it to heaven so that when I'm standing beside Jay and Aunt Helen and singing, I'm going to hit like three different octaves and they're still the same one. It's going to be so awesome. But you know, with that in mind, when Jesus came to earth, he set the example for us. And one of the things that he did while he was here was he prayed to his Father. So for those of you that don't think prayer is important, think again. Because if Jesus did it, then I know I need to do it. And he prayed with so much passion. He even taught us how to pray. And so at this time, we're about to embark on such a pivotal aspect of our relationship that's through prayer. I consider myself to have a strong prayer life, but I want it to get even stronger. I want you to take the time right now, before we get on our hands and knees, to analyze your prayer life. Personalize. Are you praying to God as much as you should? Like, I'm serious. Like, really think about it. Have your best friend. I communicate with my best friend in Bermuda through WhatsApp pretty much every day. Are you communicating with God every single day? Are you giving him like 2 minutes here? Or are you really spending time with him through prayer? If it's not where you want to be, pray while I'm praying that God will increase your prayer time with him. At this time, if you have any prayer requests, just raise your hand. I say it all the time, I don't need to know what it is. The one who does need to know, he knows. And the one who can answer it knows. And if you feel so inclined to come forward because you feel like, Kimmy, man, these burdens are so heavy. Almighty, I want to lay down the altar and come forward at this time. Please put yourself in a state of reverence, whether you're kneeling, sitting, standing, while we prepare to approach the throne of God. While Jay and the praise team just sing a song for the prayer. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, at this time I come on behalf of your congregation that are physically here in this church, those that are watching on YouTube and on our Facebook page. And before I come to you, Lord, I ask that you please cleanse me and forgive me of all unrighteousness, sins that I may have knowingly committed, and even sins that I did not know I committed. Cleanse me, Lord, as I come on behalf of your people. We just talked about the importance of prayer, Lord, and some of us, our prayer life, it's not too strong. And right now, individually, each person who knows that their prayer life is not strong is asking, Lord, please work on my heart. Work on improving my communication with you through prayer. Lord, I'll be honest, I enjoy waking up early mornings. No traffic, no TV, no radio, just you and I communicating each morning, getting spiritually dressed, putting on the full armor of God. We can't make it without you, Lord. And prayer is an integral part in our relationship with you, that communication line. You said it in one of those songs, call me up. Call me up. And so we call on you right now, Lord. Be with your church members. Be with your children. Some of us have had a very trying week. We wanted to throw the towel in each and every day. But because of our prayer line, our communication line with you, you have given us the energy, the fortitude to be able to keep on keeping on. It's not easy being a child of the King. Satan hates us. Each and every day he formulates a plan to try to take us out, to destroy us. But here we are, sometimes bruised and beaten, but we're still standing. We're in the 12th round of a heavyweight fight. Nose is busted, eye is beaten, lips are busted. And there you are in our corner. And then, soon as we are about to fall, you come in. Catch us like a tag team, and there you go, knocking Satan to the floor. Lord, we look forward to that 10 count when he says, it is over, and you break through the clouds. And those of us that have a strong prayer life, that continue to set the example at work, at school, and at play of a Christ-like example, we look forward to that day when we will spend eternity with you, putting on our long white robe, feasting on milk and honey, singing and never getting tired, walking on streets of gold. We look forward to that day, Lord, when we will meet up with our loved ones that we've lost here on earth, that have gone to sleep in you.
I can go down a list right now of those people that we've lost. But I know one that's on top of my list, my dad. And Lord, we ask that we continue to live this Christ-filled life. Fill our cups up. Let it overflow. We look forward to that day. But in the meantime, let us continue to hold on to your hand. Take us through the storms. And when we're ready to give up, Lord, pick us up and carry us. We love you. We appreciate you. And we don't want to take you for granted. Bless each person in this place today. Give them an extra blessing. And when we walk out that door this afternoon after the service is complete, let us not leave church and Jesus here in this building, but carry him in our hearts, in our actions, in our words, even in our diet. All these things, Lord, we ask in the precious name of Jesus, who came to earth, died on the cross, rested on Saturday, and rose early Sunday morning. In Jesus' name we pray, let everyone say, amen, amen, and amen. Nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious Jesus. Draw me nearer again, Jay. Draw me nearer. Draw me nearer. Yes. Nearer, blessed Lord, to thy crown, and how has done. Draw me nearer. Draw me nearer. Draw me nearer. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, church. Amen. Y'all can just take the time to imagine this song with me. Just think about what it's going to be like when we get to see our Jesus face to face. The sky shall unfold, preparing his entrance. The stars shall applaud him with thunders of praise. shall behold him. Then face to face we shall behold. Oh yes, we shall behold him.
Thank you. Yeah. There's many that don't understand, but once you've been through some things, once you've been through some things, we realize there's nothing but God that's gotten us through. We have quite a few members that are under the weather, I would say. Brother Paris, we lift him up in prayer. Brother Anthony Taylor, even our very own brother, where our elders had already blessed you, Brother Monroe, we know that you're prepping up. And you know, I was listening to something where, you know, at times we can say, we understand, but yet do we? At times that we're not in somebody else's shoes, we do understand that there is a higher power, God the Creator, amen? And so even as the psalmist said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art what? With me, thy rod and thy staff shall comfort. Praise the Lord, church. I want to praise God for the wonderful service that we have had thus far with those singing to the glory of God. Amen? And like Sister Shauna Kay said, blessed assurance. That's what keeps us going. Amen? That's what keeps us going when we feel as though there's no way. Blessed assurance. And as Brother Jay was saying, just imagine what it'll be like when we see Jesus face to face. And he holds out his hands and you see the markings of the nails and you see the gash in his side. He's going to say, you don't owe me anything. It was a pleasure because we're all here now. Amen? You can't fathom it, but it's going to happen. And so today, we just want to thank the Lord that he's given us another opportunity to get it right. To get it right with someone else. To get it right with those that may have felt as though they have done wrong to us, but we're not keeping score. What we have to do is have forgiving hearts. Amen? And keep pushing forward and shedding the light of Jesus Christ into somebody's life. Remember, we only plant the seed. We can't force it to grow. We just have to leave it in the Holy Spirit's hands. Amen? So today, we're going to get straight into the Word. Praise the Lord. I'm going to invite you to turn to the book of Philippians, chapter 4. By God's grace, the Holy Spirit had helped me to share this with our brothers and sisters down at St. Paul a few weeks ago. And it's a powerful message because it talks about how we should maintain this endurance for the Lord. Amen? Philippians chapter 4, verses 10 to 13. If you don't mind, if those that can stand, please stand as we read the Word of God. If you can stand, please stand. As we, the verse is on the projector. Philippians 4, verses 10 through 13. And praise the Lord, for thus this is the Apostle Paul talking. The Bible says, but I what? Rejoiced in the Lord greatly, that now at the last your care of me have flourished again, wherein ye were also careful, but ye lacked opportunity. He also goes on to say that not that I speak in respect of want, for I have planned in whatsoever state I am. Therewith to be content, I know both how to be abased and I know how to be abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to be abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthened me. For the next few moments, I invite you to take this journey with Paul as he writes this letter under the title, He Didn't Quit. He Didn't Quit. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, help us, Lord. Lord God, we are living in a world that has been prophetic, that we know that the imminent coming of Jesus Christ is soon. Lord God, we heard on the television yesterday that a man doused himself with an accelerant, perhaps gasoline, and lit himself on fire in front of the courthouse in New York City. Lord God, we know the devil is busy because you would not have us try to take our lives senselessly. For whatever was going on in that man's mind, Lord, we pray that you touch him from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. He's still alive. So we pray for him right now, Lord. Lord, we pray for every mind, Lord, that may have been corrupted right now by the enemy. And we pray that your Holy Spirit will be in full force, grabbing the attention of the mind and the hearts of your creation. So, Lord God, I pray that you allow this willing soul to be behind the cross and to be a vessel that is used by you. May you forgive me of my sins and blot out my transgressions, and may we pray for the baptism of the Holy Spirit in our lives. So now give us the comprehension and understanding of the reading of your word, as it may it be a blessing to all of us here today, and may we share that blessing with someone else. Lord, be with our sick and shut-in, and we thank you for the powerful prayer and songs that was sung and lifting you up today, Father. For this is our prayer in Jesus' name, that the church of the living God say amen, amen, and amen. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. He didn't quit. In 1636, amid the darkness of the 30 Years' War, this was a war that began as a religious war fought between Roman Catholics and Protestants in Germany. A German pastor by the name of Martin Rinkart is said to have buried, listen to this, said to have buried 5,000 of his parishioners in 1 year. Remember, churches was on fire, so it wasn't impossible to seize that many parishioners in one church. Or maybe he had a few which was all come together, but 5,000 parishioners in 1 year, an average of 15 a day. See, none of us know what it's like to be at war, amen, except for the spiritual war. But none of us are living in Israel right now. None of us are living in Palestine right now. None of us are going through what each other is dealing with. None of us are living in a third world country where individuals are lying dead on the street like it's nothing, or in Mexico doing with the cartels. You see, this man saw carnage. And to say that you're burying 15 people that you have come close to love, to have baptized, to have helped them out through their situations is insane. His parish was ravaged by war, death, and economic disaster. And in the heart of that darkness, with the cries of fear outside his window, he sat down and wrote a table grace for his children. It went something like this. It says, now thank we all our God with heart and hands and voices who wondrous things have done and whom his world rejoices, who from our mother's arms hath led us on our ways with countless gifts of love and still in our today. You see, he didn't allow the despair of the darkness that was going on to have him quit on God. He stayed focused and he stayed giving praise of hope and joy through the drama that was in his life. Here was a man who knew thanksgiving, a man who knew comfort, a man who knew peace comes from the love of God and not from outward circumstances. It isn't a secret that this world has seen what? Many wars during this time, have we? It's nothing new. The Bible said that there will be rumors of wars that would take place. So nothing is new under the sun, but the wars that have taken the lives of millions of men on the bloodstained battlefields around the globe. Women and children have also become the victims of circumstances to the consequences of war as well. It's hard to believe, saints of God, that anyone could still maintain hope such as that pastor after witnessing so much carnage, yet he still praised God during his loss. He still praised God in the midst of his pain, and he still praised God in the midst of his suffering. That's why this pastor, he didn't quit. Lord knows none of us want to believe that anything good can come out of suffering. And the reason is we hate even the idea of suffering. How many of us have had a paper cut in your life and know what that feels like? You know? What about when you're walking at night and you don't see the end of the bedpost and you stump your toe? Don't nobody like that, because sometimes some words come out of our mouths that we typically don't say. Amen? Praise the Lord for grace. But there's something about suffering that we don't like. Having to hear a doctor say, well, we're going to operate in the next few days. We don't want to hear that, even if it's a simple procedure. But praise God that when we have the Holy Spirit with us, we have hope that we'll see each other on the other side. For those of us over 50 understand what I'm talking about, because when we wake up in the morning, them brittle bones start to pop and the back starts to hurt, them knees start to pop, etc., etc., etc. Yet seriously, many wake up every morning with an affliction that causes some suffering. I'm 50 years old, and I know my body don't feel the same. I told my wife the other morning, man, my body hurts. Now, I could be doing some stretching. I could be doing some exercise, but yet that's what happens. Our bodies start to break down. That's the process of sin. Not saying you've committed the sin, but the sin that was brought on to mankind in the very beginning. Every human being is created by God will encounter situations that will be difficult, that will be overwhelming, and faith testing, trouble with the rebellious child, difficulties at work, dealing with health issues, relationship issues with your family, financial stress, and a multitude of other circumstances. You see, Paul's letter to the Philippians brings us to the focus of our text this afternoon, so that whenever we face various situations, saints of God, in our lives, we can rely on this verse, which is meant to speak to us. That verse of Philippians chapter 4, verses 10 through 13 makes it very clear that we can do all things through God that strengthens us. Here in the text, we find the Apostle Paul in prison in Rome awaiting trial under the tyrannical rulership of the Roman Emperor Nero, an emperor who spared no love for those who identified themselves as Christians. Nero didn't even want to look at you if you loved Jesus Christ. He hated you. He despised you. So nothing better would make him happy was to kill Christians. And the prison system during that time was often described as harsh and inhumane, Elder Smith. Prisoners were subjected to overcrowding. Prisoners were subjected to the lack of sanitation and poor living conditions. Many prisoners were also subjected to torture or other forms of physical punishment. I don't know about you, but anyone that has been incarcerated can tell you that prison is not a pretty place. I don't know. I can't say that I've spent sometime, but I do remember spending a good 24 hours behind bars due to a DUI. And let me tell you, I said to myself, I don't want to come back to this place. And that was only 24 hours. For those that have had to go through that incarceration, praise God that you were able to get through, and praise God that he was able to talk to you to help you so you don't go back. These living quarters of inconvenience were designed to what? Torture a prisoner psychologically and physically into confessing or recanting their faith. Man, they did everything they could to try to get individuals to say, I don't love Jesus. Oh, there was lots of brutality. And some of these things we don't like to think about. When I said that paper cut and stomping your toe, that's just small potatoes compared to what was going on with the torture that they did to some of these individuals who called out the name of Jesus. Knowing that his death is imminent, Paul writes his epistles to the Philippians as he hearkens back to the church at Philippi. He loved Philippi. And let me tell you why, because there was something special about that church. It was a church that was a source of joy to him. This church that was a source of joy to him, this church was planted due to a vision that Paul was given in Acts 16. I know what it feels like to be in love with your church. Amen? Let me say that again. I know what it feels like to be in love with your church, because you know that when you watch yourself, you're watching yourself grow with individuals. And you know what? The Bible says iron sharpens iron. So if there's ever a pastor that thinks that they can't learn something from their members, then they got it all wrong. It's because we're all trying to go to the same place, right? And I always know that as the shepherd of the flock, I'm under the great shepherd. So I take my leadership very seriously, but I take it with the understanding that I don't know everything. I don't know everything. So we need each other, amen? We need to be a church body. We need to have a membership. We need to be a family. And though we may not always agree, we don't have to be disagreeable. But Paul loved this church, and these wealthy and socially well-placed believers of Philippi supplied Paul with friendship and financial support during his ministry and his imprisonment. It was there that selflessness greatly increased Paul's joy in the Lord. There's nothing like when someone is helping you, amen? There's nothing like when you're helping someone else, amen? You see, there's a joy about going and doing for others. And when somebody just decides to say, hey, I've done this for you, not so much that they're trying to get, but they're like, can I help you out? I love it when Sister Janice makes me container of sorrow. And let me tell you something, Brother Jay, we can admit that is a mean batch of punch. Amen? No alcohol in there. Come on now. No alcohol. But that sorrow is real. And let me tell you something. You might think you're just making it, right? But when I see that in the refrigerator after my wife, after a day, I look at it and I say, it's going to be a good night. Because there's nothing like when you know people have put love into something. You get what I'm saying? There's nothing like that, and you feel appreciated. And this is how Paul is feeling. Paul is thinking back to the good times, even though he's in this prison that is filthy, even though he's in this prison where somebody else's fecal material or urine is on the other side, although he's in this prison where he's being tortured, Paul understands and goes back to those good old days. Amen? And so now Paul writes to them, demonstrating his gratitude, along with sharing an important lesson that he hopes will stay with them throughout their journey in their fellowship with Jesus Christ. You see, Paul reminds the church in Philippi along with us in verses 1 through 5 to always seek unity when we disagree with our fellow Christians. That's what Paul is talking about. Verses 1 and 5, for the sake of time, go back to it tonight when you start to read chapter 4. Look at what the verse is saying. It's saying that we need to seek unity when we disagree with our fellow Christians. We're not supposed to hold grudges. We're not supposed to say it's my way or the highway. We're supposed to reason together. Amen? We ain't supposed to be looking at the other one and cutting your eyes. You know, we talked about something today, and I'm going to be honest. You know, there, you can come in and dress just like one of the pioneers, and it won't get you into heaven. Because if your heart is nasty and it's ugly and it's deceitful, you're going to bust H-E-double-L wide open. And we know that doesn't exist, because God's saying, I will just wipe you out. Verses 6 through 9, he encourages to remain in peace when we are prone to worry. Oh, yeah. Let me tell you something. As a human being, it's easy to worry. Amen? It's easy to worry. And so I say to individuals, you know what? It's okay to be concerned, but guess what? Just leave it in God's hands. That is a struggle we have to fight with, and don't turn and say, man, I'm less of a Christian. Where is my faith? No, don't do that. Just go reach out to God and say, help me right now so that I can see the road ahead, because I know that I'm not in control of my destiny until I start giving it to you. Here in verse 10 and 13, Paul provides the secret recipe that provides the power we need for life and service. Hear me, church. Will the church allow me to give everyone some helpful advice this afternoon? Are you with me? Okay, all right. Here it is. If you think walking with Jesus is a walk in the park, you will be disappointed. Come on now. If you think walking with Jesus is a walk in the park, you will be disappointed. In other words, when we choose to leave Satan alone and walk with Jesus, trouble is going to always come our way. Am I lying to somebody today? If someone thought that there would be pie in the sky because God is going to just rain down fire on all our enemies, open every door we've asked for, raise back to life our loved ones because of our tears, you have another thing coming. Although we have decided to follow Jesus doesn't grant us a trouble-free pass in the life. But I'm here to tell you, don't quit. You see, Jesus made it very clear to us in Luke chapter 9, verses 23, and he said, "All, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me." Now, historians and theologians and archaeologists have stated that the crucifixion cross could weigh close to 175 to 300 pounds. My Lord, are you hearing me? 175 pounds to 300. And Christ's walk took him a little over 3 hours to get from Jerusalem to Calvary. My Lord. Basically, Jesus is saying when we choose to deny self, we will have some substantial burdens to carry. The burdens of temptations, the burdens of maturing, of relationships, the burdens of marriage, the burdens of family life, the burdens of finances, the burdens of divorce, the burdens of being dissatisfied, the burdens of mental health, the burdens of sickness, loneliness, and grief. Those are burdens that all of us may end up suffering from. Maybe one or two, maybe three or four. But there is going to be some kind of burden in our lives that we are going to have to face, which brings us to our text of concentration, verse 13 of chapter 4. Therefore, Paul says, I can do all things through Christ, through him that strengthens me. That's who he's talking about, Jesus Christ. Allow me to pause right here and ask the question, how many of us have used this scripture text whenever a challenge has come our way? How many of us? How many of us has used this scripture text? Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. Perhaps as a young person taking a test, you may refer to verse 13, giving you relief that you surely will receive an A, all right? Is it possible we've used this text when we lack the courage to try something new? Is it possible we've used this text to prove that no matter what stands in the way, we will overcome the obstacle? When if I told you that often we've misinterpreted the true meaning of Paul's message, would you be shocked? Uh-oh, wait, we're going somewhere. Perhaps Paul isn't saying that through the strength of Jesus Christ, we become some kind of Christian superhero. Are you hearing me? With supernatural strength, yet become something more powerful than we ever imagined. You see, the reason I'm saying this is because often we can set our sights on our own expectations in life that God doesn't even have in store for us. Maybe you weren't supposed to get that A. What happens when you get the B? Do you stop relying on God? Oh, yeah. We're getting somewhere with this. Because it's not bad to use that text towards that, but understand that perhaps what you seek to get through, what you seek your strength to get through, is not what God wants you to do. Are you hearing me now? Stay with me. The reason I'm saying this is because oftentimes, we find ourselves looking at how we're automatically going to see ourselves going through the process. For example, when we read the text, we can conclude that we what? Can do not some things, but all things. In him that strengthens us, that's Jesus Christ. However, what happens if I'm paralyzed from the waist down and told I'll never walk again? Why hasn't my outcomes changed after I've surrendered and over again? I'm in prayer, fasting 3 times a week, and studying the word for hours, fixated on 4:13, when it says, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. But my legs won't allow me to do that, what I want them to do. Where's the strength that I so dearly need now? See, this is when the devil comes in. The devil likes to play around with the semantics. See, the Bible isn't semantics, but he'll shift it into semantics. Are you hearing me? See, the reason I say this is because many of us will read the Bible and quote scripture for our benefit. Yet when we don't get the results from God, we'll turn away in disgust. We'll turn away in despair. We'll turn away in disappointment. And some of us, if truth be told, would have no problem following Job's wife's advice after he was afflicted with sores when she says, do you still retain your integrity? Curse God and die. That's strong, isn't it? She said, curse God and die. How dare he after all the tithe you've given? How dare ye after all the prayer meetings you've spoken at? How dare he after all the sermons you preach? How dare he curse you? But all understand that everything we go through in life is for a reason. Satan will use every weapon available to persuade us to what? Quit relying on God. Let us not forget that we are selfish within our nature, aren't we? Go ahead and leave that last piece of food in the refrigerator and see who's going to think about somebody else first. Oh, you know what? I'll take that last sip of orange juice. Come on now. We're just like that in nature. If we don't sit back and take a step back and think of it as, you know what, it would be best if I just go out and buy a new container of juice, all right? You feel me? That way everybody is happy. But sometimes we do that. Now, am I saying that you are sinning because you did that? No. Please don't let nobody take that in consideration. What I'm saying is that we do think about ourselves when it comes down to it at times if we don't let God lead us. Come on now. We're born into sin, shaped in iniquity. Don't front. We can be selfish, especially when it comes to our feelings. And so the thing of it is if we don't get our way, we can become easily dissatisfied. We are selfish as babies. Take that bottle away from that baby and see how that baby acts. He or she will make sure those tears come out their eyes and the screams will not stop until that bottle or pacifier goes in their mouth. Mothers, am I telling the truth? I remember Jay would be in the back of that car seat foaming at the mouth, yanking and yanking his legs. And I'm like, this little man is driving me crazy. But when he wanted it, that's when he's tried. But then you get to the age where you got to let them know you ain't going to always get everything because you're crying. Are you hearing me? You're not going to always get everything. And guess what? God says the same thing to us. You're not going to always get everything because you're crying right now. Sometimes you're going to have to learn patience. I told somebody the other day that the biggest problem we have as Christians is that we're impatient. We're very impatient. Because waiting on God is saying that I need to wait on somebody else before I can satisfy myself. Are you hearing me? You got to wait on somebody, even God, because we like to be satisfied. And truth be told, it doesn't take much to get dissatisfied. We get dissatisfied with our jobs. We get dissatisfied with government policies. We get dissatisfied with family, doctors, dissatisfied in our marriage, and even dissatisfied with God. And even right now, even though we're dressed in our Sabbath best, I wonder how many of us are just barely holding on, ready to throw in the towel and quit due to the fact that you are dissatisfied with God right now. If you are this afternoon, I'd like for you to look at Paul, because if there was one who could have been dissatisfied with the outcomes in his life, the circumstances as a follower of Christ, it should have been him. Are you hearing me? Yet Paul gives us a lesson for the true believer that will change the way we respond towards the situations within our circumstances, because Paul, repeat after me, he didn't quit. You see, Paul says, starting in verse 10, but I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at last you have revived your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned before, but you lacked an opportunity to act. Not that I speak from need, for I have learned to be content. Oh, that's a big word right there. In whatever circumstances I am, I know how to get along with little. And I also know how to live in prosperity. See, Paul has been there and done that. And in any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of being filled and going hungry, both of having abundance and suffering in need. I can do all things through who? Christ, who strengthens me. Now, get it now. Paul is saying that he has learned to be content in every situation. How many of us, are show of hands, can say we've been content in every situation? It's a hard thing, ain't it? Looking at yourself, talk to yourself and say, have I been content? Whether he has a lot of success or little, whether he is full or hungry, whether he's on top of the world and on the lowest of the valleys. How in the world did Paul allow himself to endure the discomfort of 195 lashes? You know, when you got lashes from the Romans, it was 45. And we know Paul had over that, right? How in the world could he endure through the discomfort of his mind being hit by rocks against his head, projectiles that are rough, smashing against his body? How could he endure when individuals are beating him with poles and pipes and sticks and rods? I'm talking about Paul was getting the beat down. And can anyone conceive taking a trip on a cruise liner and not once, not twice, but three times get shipwrecked? This is what happened to Paul, but yet he says, I've been content in all my circumstances. Oh, my Lord. Yet, praise be to God, Paul kept on moving with his eyes on the prize and the kingdom, because what we all learn from the Apostle Paul's epistles is that life is not a series of accidents. It's a series of appointments. That's why he didn't quit. Repeat after me. He didn't quit. So Paul reveals to the church in Philippi, along with every one of us, is that no matter what happens in our life, we can't allow the devil to have us worrying ourselves to death over the outcomes of our circumstances that we have no control of. Did you know that anxiety levels are the highest for people between the ages of 40 and 60? The peak levels were noted that those in their 50s to 54 age group. For this reason, many life circumstances can cause what? Midlife anxiety. It's quiet because a lot of us are 50 plus, amen? The problems we experience can very well trigger anxiety in all of us, especially generalized anxiety disorder that involves a persistent feeling of anxiety or dread that is not the same as occasionally worrying, yet can interfere with how we live our lives in a constant state of fear. If there's anybody out there that knows what generalized anxiety disorder is, if you don't, you don't want to have it, because I dealt with it back sometime with 2017, where I was in constant fear, and it was all about a grade. And it took me from because my professor said, anybody that has five punctuational mistakes in this 12-page paper automatically gets a D. I told my wife that, five. And in 12-page paper, meaning if you didn't have this period here or something else, five, you're done. I just went flip because my whole GPA was already like 4.0. You get what I'm saying? No, like 3.5. And through that, I couldn't go anywhere without stressing about that. It got so bad that I had to call my father, and he drove 2 hours just to try to console me. Each and every night, I could not go to bed. I was crying. I was upset. I even went to the doctors, and my practitioner said to me, there's something wrong with you. And then next thing you know, they had to give me something. They had to give me something. And I know an individual, and I'm telling you, so we were watching something last night where I was like, back in the day, even on a Christian channel, we was watching something on 3ABN where the individual said, you know what? Today, due to mental illness, it's okay to take a pill. Are you hearing me? Before, they would tell you, go pray it away. But we got to understand something. Heredity, right? Because in my family cycle, on my dad's side, my grandmother had bipolar schizophrenia. And so mental illness will run in the track of your family. And guess what? It had hit me with this situation. Something triggered something within me. But I know it's somebody that said, you know what? I'm going to take it to the altar. And you know what they did? They tried to go cold turkey for 3 months. And guess what happened to them? They nearly lost their mind. And so we got to be careful in understanding that there are things that will cause us to go and hit these mental illness issues. But yet, hear me though, if it wasn't for the grace of God, for the support that I had and the support that my friend had and the support that we need to give to one another when we're going through these crucial hard times. It's not easy for somebody to have a family member in the hospital and you hear that something wrong is going on. That's when we get right to our knees and start lifting them up in prayer. We can't start to listen on the news and hear about what's going on the church up the street and condemning them. We need to be praying for our brothers and sisters. Are you hearing me? See, in this body of selfishness, we love drama. And we need to stay away from the drama. Because if we're not careful, the great controversy is about what? It's about pertaining to who's going to control the mind. And so what happens is, I read an article and it talked about an individual who was scared of Lyme disease, right? And he caught Lyme disease before, and this was unfortunate because after he had Lyme disease, he did everything he could to try to prevent from getting it. And so it got to such a point that when he thought his wife had it, right? He did everything. He thought she was going to die. He thought he was going to die. And do you know what? This individual ended up, after doctors had told him already that he would not be able to get it because in the area he lived, he killed himself and his wife. He killed himself and his wife because he said they'd rather end their lives than endure what he had went through the first time. You see, a lot of times we're going to go through some things that are going to be worse than what we dealt with before. And we got to learn, how do we able to stand away from not being paralyzed in our own fears? Brothers and sisters, I can't deny that mental health is real, yet there are those issues that we bring on ourselves because we are constantly living in fear, worrying about things we cannot control. Allow the preacher to give you some advice, which is to remember, worrying is worshiping your problems. Are you hearing me? And if circumstances are gaining more worship than our God, then we have a problem. Amen? Stop letting the fear of this world hold you back and from taking back what the devil has stolen from you. And don't give up and fight back with the Holy Spirit by your side and keep running your race to glory. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For God has not given us a spirit of what? Fear. But of power, love, and self-control." What more can we do to overcome this fear? Well, we can do more praying. We can do more fasting. We can do more studying. We can do more teaching. We can do more serving. We can do more encouraging. We can do more comforting. We can do more praising and a lot more loving. Are you hearing me this afternoon? Paul may not have had all the resources needed for comfortability. However, it was enough because all he needed was to be filled with the Holy Spirit and profess the true witness of Jesus Christ. That's what kept him on the fire for the Lord. That's why he did not what? Quit. There's a great necessity for us to realize our dependence on God. Paul understood too well of God's provisions in his life. That's the reason why he could be what? Content. You see, that text is talking not so much about getting this strength to be able to get through, because guess what? When God has you, you're going to get through. He's just trying to tell you is you have the power, just be content in the circumstance. You see, there's an assumption of equating contentment with laziness. Are you hearing me? Have you seen somebody and you say, oh, they're content, they're just lazy? No. Hear this now. Contentment does not mean we stop learning. Contentment doesn't mean we stop growing. Contentment doesn't mean that we're not being productive. It just means we do all those things from a place of comfort and joy. Are you hearing me? Rather than from fear and anxiety, James tells us to what? Commit it all joy, my brothers, when we meet trials of various kinds. For you, the testing of your faith produces what? Steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Stay with me, because we're going somewhere right now, because Paul learned to be content, yet with power. Are you hearing me? Paul stayed content, but with power, Sister Sharika. I know how to get along with little. I also know how to live in what? Prosperity. And in every circumstances, I have learned the secret of being filled and going hungry. Both I have abundance and suffering need. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. You see, Paul uses the word secret or mystery, which in the Greek is translated mysterio, to explain the truth that have been once hidden by now brought to light. You see, that secret or that mysterio was that he could do all things through Christ who strengthens him, and understand that the Christian life is truly a mystery, isn't it? It is an enigma to us, because times when we think we're doing right, we find out we're doing wrong, and then we try to say and try to make an excuse on why we do things. Well, the Bible said that David was a man after God's own heart, so with all the adultery I've been doing, God still loves me. Are you hearing me? People do that. But we have to understand that we are taught through the Holy Spirit how to survive in this God-forsaken world through our own personal experience. Now, when Paul says, I can do all things, the Greek translation word for can do means to be strong, be powerful, be able to prevail over. Despite in this common translation, the verb used 27 times in the New Testament is never translated can do. Elsewhere, Paul is not saying that he can do all things through Christ. Indeed, Paul wouldn't be granted wings to fly like an eagle through Jesus Christ, but rather he could do what? He could prevail or have victory over any circumstances by relying on Christ and his strength. Are you hearing me? Don't go and try to say, I can climb Mount Everest, because the Bible says I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. No, what that text is saying is that you can prevail through all things. You can prevail through the divorce. You can prevail through the death. You can prevail through the poor. You can prevail through the issues in your life. It does not matter. With God, you can prevail through your addiction. And though you may have trouble in school, live in a dysfunctional household, carry around oxygen just to breathe, your eyesight may no longer be 20/20, your memory is slipping, and cancer may be devouring your body from the inside out. However, the Bible tells me in Psalms 91, whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. When we continuously surrender to the Holy Spirit, we have the victory in Jesus. 1 Peter 4:11 reminds us that whoever speaks as one who speaks the utterance of God, whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. So therefore, no trial or tragedy is too hard to face in with Jesus Christ's power, because Jesus Christ's power enables us to stand firm on the promises and endure the difficult of life's challenges. You see, saints of God, before I take my seat, Jesus gave Paul the ability to endure till death. And he followed in the steps of Christ, never once complaining, nor did he quit. Before the Holy Spirit came about, we have to understand that Jesus, before he ascended, said, before I leave, I have to leave the Comforter. And praise God that he did, because if he didn't, we would all lose our minds. Amen? None of us would have tried to walk up for the appeal. None of us would have decided to get baptized. None of us would have believed that we wouldn't have been out of our circumstances. But if it was not for the Holy Spirit, where would we be? But I want to share with some of you today the good news for the saints, and even to the ain'ts who are sitting here today who might be ingesting the spiritual manna that is being offered this afternoon. You see, the reason Paul can suffer through the carnage of war, or precisely, even though the pastor that we talked about could deal with this carnage of war and still remain hopeful, thankful, and content with God is because he understood that he could do all things through Christ that strengthened him. The reason Paul could remain in Rome's most wanted and take a licking and keep on ticking and still give glory to God is because he knows someone. Are you hearing me today? You see, there's something about the name of Jesus. There's something about the name of Jesus that will allow us to see beyond ourselves. There's something about the name of Jesus that will give us the stamina to walk through the valley of the shadow of death and fear no evil. There's something about the name of Jesus that we were ready to throw in the towel, yet Jesus is standing right over us saying, you can do all things. You can prevail through all things, but you must understand you just can't quit. When he had every opportunity to give up, but when he struggled at Gethsemane, he chose to say nothing less, not my will, but yours done, Jesus, was content because he didn't quit. When he was handed over to Pilate and chosen to be crucified over Barabbas, Jesus was content. He did not quit. When he was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities, Jesus was content. He did not quit. When he journeyed up towards Calvary with the weight of not only the cross, yet with the weight of humanity's sin, Jesus was content. He did not quit. And when he was hung high and then stretched wide, they hung his head from just for you and me, he died. Jesus was content and he did not die. Yet he said it was finished because it was through his strength that gives us the strength that allows us to be able to be strong, to be powerful, thus prevail over any circumstance because Jesus has given us the victory. So I'm here today to tell you that if Jesus did not quit, Jesus is trying to tell you, no matter how bad the circumstances may be, don't you quit. No matter how difficult the job may be, don't you quit. No matter how dysfunctional your family may be, just don't quit. No matter what you're going through, and if your house is upside down or issues you're watching outside, just don't quit, because Jesus says you can prevail through all things through Christ that strengthens me. Not some things, not a few things, but all things. There's coming a day that Jesus is going to reward us. And when we can see him crashing through the sky, we will be so excited to know that we can behold him as you sing. You see, Jesus is the reason why we're here. Jesus gives us the DNA not to quit. Whenever we feel as though we're afraid to stand in front of others, we just got to ask, Lord, baptize me in your Holy Spirit and give me the opportunity to stand 10 toes strong so that we can get through. So Jesus didn't quit so that we can quit. Jesus isn't done yet. He has one more prophetic work to do, family, and that is to come back for those who have chosen truly to say, I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me. If Jay, if you would play something for us, please. The light tune. There's a story of a man who found a barn where Satan kept his seeds ready to be sown in the human heart. He found that the seeds of discouragement were more numerous than the others. And he learned that those seeds could be made to grow almost anywhere. But when Satan was questioned, Elder Benz, he reluctantly admitted that there was one place in which he could never get them to thrive. And where is that? Asked the man. Satan replied sadly, in the heart of a grateful person. You see, Paul was grateful that he was able to get a second chance. Remember, if it wasn't for that walk on Damascus Road to change his life, he would have been that same Pharisee. And although many of us were never Pharisees, we did have an alternate life. How many of us are grateful that Jesus changed us? That we can actually celebrate in the midst of our addictions, that we can celebrate in the midst of our grief, that we can celebrate in the midst of all the things that hurt us to the core. But there's something supernatural about having Jesus in our lives. Through all the tears that we shed in this life, there's a day coming where we won't have to worry about the small things and the big things, all the things that trouble us. There'd be a day where nobody will pick sides. I saw a church say, pray for Israel. I told my wife, they should be saying, pray for everybody that's being drawn into this thing. God doesn't like to see death. Are you hearing me? He doesn't enjoy it, not by his creation. It was only one time God had decided that a nation had to be wiped out because he had already known that they just were not going to get it right. But God gave the order. I don't think the commander-in-chief is given the order to start sending missiles back and forth. Are you hearing me? So if there's a war raging in your heart and your mind right now, it could be anything. Just know right now you can give it to God. And stop beating yourself up and saying, I'm not worthy. We've said it over and over again. Due to Jesus dying on the cross, we are worthy. We are worthy to come to him at any time. And don't ever feel ashamed. Are you hearing me? Just know that God will get us in the right direction. It just means we got to be patient with ourselves. We got to be patient with others. And we have to definitely be patient with God. So if you seek God to just help work the impatience in your life, stand with me so we can pray all together. You want God to help work out and strengthen our patience. Because God's not going to allow you to go through that door to the next phase of your life unless you're ready. So be patient, because that new job is coming. Be patient, because you might come out of one broken relationship, but God has a new relationship for you. But he wants to strengthen you and make you better than you were in the last one. Whatever it may be, whatever door, whatever blessing you're asking for God, just be patient. Sister Iris is going 2 years with getting that new kidney. Patience. And it wasn't easy, was it? And now she's able to give other people hope. Just be patient. It's coming. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Father God, for the church family of New Life. We thank you, Lord, that we are determined, Father God, to not talk the talk, but walk the walk. We're determined to be light bearers to one another and to the community. We're determined to be blessed by the Holy Spirit to strengthen our patience right now. And Lord, not just the Church of New Life, but also everyone, anybody right now that is watching, we're asking that you give us, Lord, more patience. And we know we're saying that prayer, things are going to come, but yet, Lord, we know that you will strengthen us as long as we just surrender and we're able to prevail through you. Lord, the text of that script is meaning is that, yes, as long as we're content You are able to move us anywhere we need to be. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you will touch every person under the sound of my voice, that you will touch us all from the crown of our head to the soles of our feet. Lord God, we pray that you will miraculously touch and answer the prayers that have been lifted up. Father God, we thank you already for answered prayer, and we thank you for being a Father that has never let us down. So now, Lord God, we're just waiting on the day for the imminent coming of your Son, Jesus, so that we can just celebrate in a land of peace. Making it to the promised land is our goal. So thank you, Father God, for the people of God here today and those that are watching. And if there's somebody watching out there who needs an extra prayer, just type in your chat. Or just already know that you are being covered. Regardless if we don't know your name or your address, we're lifting you up in prayer right now. So, Father God, thank you for blessing us with your word. For this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Let the Church of the Living God say amen, amen, and amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen. We want to thank Pastor Thorpe for such an inspiring sermon. He didn't quit. Where would we be if he did? Wow. Well, today, again, it's a beautiful Sabbath day. Brother
Amen.
Trey, do we have AY today? No AY today. So, you know, spend time in the Word. Reach out to someone.
Get some fresh air.
I was just going to say, even though it's a lot of pollen, man, it looks like the children took the sidewalk chalk sometimes, and you know how it just blows everywhere. That stuff is deadly. If you need to wear a mask, wear a mask. But appreciate being alive,
yeah,
being in good health, having the opportunity to still come and publicly worship on the Sabbath day. Some countries don't get this opportunity. So enjoy the Sabbath. Reach out to loved ones in sick and shut-in. At this time, we're going to ask for everyone to please stand while we are dismissed. And then as the pastor and I go out, we'll greet you at the front. And please remain seated until the ushers are able to usher you out. Kind and gracious Eternal Father, you've given us a tremendous word today. We thank you that it was able to penetrate our hearts and our minds. Help it to change us and transform us, that we won't give in or quit when Satan seems like he's got the upper hand. Our ultimate goal is to spend eternity with you. So help us on this journey to salvation. And as we are confronted with pitfalls and all sorts of obstacles that will come our way, we continue to trust and rely and put our complete faith totally in you, Lord, and give us the fortitude to not quit, so that one day when you break through those clouds of heaven, we will be caught up to spend eternity with you. Thank you so much for all that you've done in the past, what you're doing for us now, and we claim what you will do for us in the future. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, you may be seated until you're ushered out.